While there is a large variety of electrical test equipment, some of which are far more interesting, we generally begin with the DC power supply. I can think of two very good reasons for this. One, DC voltages are simple. Two, without DC, the more interesting circuits tend not to do anything. DC, or direct current, simply refers to electrical phenomena that are constant in time. The term DC is used interchangeably to refer to voltage, the pushing power for electricity, or current, the flow of electrical charge. Because of this, you may hear people use the seemingly redundant term DC current, but this is necessary to differentiate it from DC voltage. As I was saying, DC refers to electrical phenomena that are constant in time. Another way of stating this would be to say that DC phenomena have a fixed polarity. Polarity is the difference between the positive and negative terminals of a battery. It comes from the fact that there are both positive and negative charges, and means that direction is important with electricity. Any of us that have made a mistake with positive and negative in an electric circuit know this all too well. We use DC to provide power to circuits. Things like phones, music players, automotive systems, and low voltage lighting systems use DC power. The most familiar DC power source may be the battery, though an argument can be made for all the wall chargers we use for our portable devices. DC is necessary for many circuits to operate. In the laboratory, we want to have a safe, reliable source of DC power that we can configure to supply a variety of voltage and current levels. An example of such a source is the Agilent E3630A triple output voltage supply. If we look at the front of the supply, we can see that there are five terminal outputs. Hold it, you just said that was a triple output supply, not a quintuple output supply. Well, voltage is the difference in electric potential between two electrical points, called nodes. For three voltage outputs, each of the voltages must be relative to some common point they share, hence the fourth terminal called common. The fifth terminal is connected to earth ground. We use earth ground as an absolute reference for voltages on earth. The fifth terminal is not directly connected to the other four terminals, and for most circuits used in introductory classes, can be ignored. Let's briefly go over the rest of the front of the display. Here we have the power supply's display. This will display the electric potential in volts and the current in amps of whichever channel is selected by the meter buttons. The meter buttons do not affect the output voltage of the supply. They only change what is displayed on the indicator. Other important indicators we have on the front panel are the overload indicators. If any of these are lit up, it generally means we have a short circuit between power and ground. If any of these are lit up, we should turn off the power supply immediately so that we do not damage our circuit. The plus 6 volt knob controls the potential between the 6 volt output and the common terminal. The plus or minus 20 volt knob controls the voltage difference between the common and the 20 volt outputs. The tracking ratio knob determines if the negative 20 volt output has the same absolute value as the positive 20 volt output. When it is set to fixed, both of the 20 volt outputs will have the same absolute magnitude, but one will be positive and one will be negative. The last thing I will point out on the front panel is the power button. This turns the power supply on and off. Now that we have a general orientation to the DC power supply's front panel, let's take a look at it in operation. Here we're set up so that we can see the output of each of the voltage terminals relative to the common terminal displayed on digital multimeters. I've used banana plug connectors to connect the power supply to each of the multimeters. Notice that all of the common terminals are connected together. The left-hand meter will display the output of the 6-volt terminal, the center meter will display the output of the positive 20-volt terminal, and the right-hand meter will display the output of the negative 20-volt output. I'll start with the voltage knobs turned fully counterclockwise, and then I will turn the power supply on. The display of the power supply and the displays of the multimeters show 0 volts right now because nothing is on. If I press the button for the 6-volt meter and turn the voltage knob on the 6-volt supply, we see that the voltage is displayed on both the power supply's display and on the multimeter's display. Sometimes there's a slight difference between these two measurements. That is why it is important to use only one device to measure all of the voltages during a project. In most cases where we are dealing with DC voltages, that will be a single digital multimeter. This will increase the consistency of our data. While this does not increase the accuracy of our results, it does increase the precision or repeatability of our measurements. If I then turn the plus or minus 20 volt knob clockwise, we see that the multimeter is connected to those outputs now register an increase in voltage. And those voltages have the same magnitude, with one being positive and one being negative. Note that the display on the power supply did not change because I did not move the 6 volt knob. The display and the meter buttons have no effect on the actual output of the power supply. They're just there so that we can have a quick way to see the approximate output voltage of the selected channel. If I select the different meter outputs, the values on the digital multimeters do not change. Let's see what the tracking ratio knob does. Watch the multimeter on the right. As I turn the knob counterclockwise, the output of the minus 20 volt output decreases, while the output of the plus 20 volt output remains the same. This gives us some extra flexibility in the output voltages we can obtain. An exercise I've often given to help students understand the DC power supply is to set up the power supply so that several voltages can be obtained at the same time without making further adjustments. If you understand voltage and how the power supply works, it should be fairly easy for you to set up the power supply so you can measure a positive 4 volts, positive 16 volts, negative 10 volts, and negative 14 volts without adjusting the power supply. If you think you understand how this might work, I encourage you to pause the video and give it a try before continuing. Now I will demonstrate. Since 4 volts is the smallest potential and is less than 6 volts, I will use the 6 volt output to obtain it. And I'm going to call that close enough. To get the positive 16 volts, I will need to use the positive 20 volt output. The negative 10 volts can be obtained by adjusting the tracking ratio so that the negative 20 volt output gives that one. Now we'll need a little creativity. We've used up all the power supply's outputs, and I still asked you to get a negative 14 volts. Remember that an electric potential is just a difference between two points. All we need in order to measure negative 14 volts is to find two points that are 14 volts apart and then choose the correct polarity. The negative 14 volts is between the minus 20 volt output and the plus 6 volt output. Since we are here, we might as well take a quick look at how to connect the power supply to what we build our circuits on for temporary laboratory projects, the breadboard.
Hey, why don't you build your circuit on me?
A brief overview of the breadboard. Breadboards look like an array of holes. Behind each of these holes is a metal clip. When a wire or component lead is inserted into the breadboard, the clip firmly contacts the lead and an electrical connection is made. There are two arrangements of clips within the board. The center of the breadboard, or section of breadboard if we have a larger breadboard, is used to build our circuits. In the center of the breadboard, there are groups of holes labeled with numbers and letters for reference. The clips behind those holes are arranged so that holes A through E in each of the numbered rows are connected, as are holes F through I. When we are building a circuit, we use each of these groups of 5 as a node. The outside section of the breadboard has longer clips. We generally use these to distribute power to our circuit. Very often, power and ground will be used at several points in a circuit, so it is neater and more convenient to have power and ground available at many points. All the points adjacent to each of the solid lines are connected. If there is a break in the line, that means the clip is not continuous for the whole length of the board. Whether the clips are continuous or not varies from breadboard to breadboard, so be sure to pay attention to the line. To bring power from the power supply to the breadboard, a banana plug connector is used to connect the power supply to the binding post of the breadboard. The binding post of the breadboard can unscrew, revealing the post has a hole in it. If we insert a jumper wire into that hole and then tighten the binding post, we can insert the other end of the jumper wire into the power strip on the breadboard. This will make whatever we connect to the binding post available along the entire length of the solid line. If we want to bring power into a particular point in the circuit area of the breadboard, all we have to do is use a jumper wire from the power strip to any node we want. Once we have connected the banana connector to the power supply, everything connected to the red wires is connected to the power supply. This concludes the introduction to the DC power supply. Hopefully this will give you a head start when you head into the laboratory. Oh yeah, go out and make it a great one.